feel that hunger, is our Savior, our Redeemer, our friend. Listen to these words that describe Jesus: a counselor, a comforter, a keeper, a spirit to embrace. And I am so glad that He is all of this. He is our wonderful, merciful Savior. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Ladies. All right. Okay. That was good. We're continuing in 1 Kings today. We'll be looking at some of the second and third chapters of 1 Kings, talking about the fact that God does judge sin. And God does bless obedience. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you again. We ask you to use your word. Touch our lives by the power of the Holy Spirit. Bring conviction according to your will. God, help us to lift up Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. We ended last week's sermon looking at the story of Bathsheba. If you remember, some of you, in the story of Bathsheba, we saw in that story the redemption of God in the life of a person who had fallen greatly. That's what we saw in that lady's life. Nevertheless, God did forgive her and used her in his work to absolutely assure the fulfillment of a promise he had made to King David. Actually, it goes all the way back to Abraham. But to King David, that his son would rule on the throne. We find that very promise in 2 Samuel in the 7th chapter. I'll read that to you. It says, "When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendant after you, who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. When he commits iniquity, I will correct him with the rod strokes of the sons of men, but my loving kindness shall not depart from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed before you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established." Now that's reading through the 16th verse. Now listen closely. Listen, the 16th verse is problematic to us. It's problematic to a lot of people because truthfully, in all truth, the kingdom of Israel was divided due to Solomon's sin. We'll talk about that as time goes on. That's a fact. All right. So a lot of people say, well, you know, a son didn't continue to sit on the throne. So that doesn't make any sense. But we need to understand this verse, especially the 16th verse, is not in reference to Solomon at all. Not at all. This verse is in reference totally to Jesus. Now, the rest of that passage I read to you, it had dual prophetic meaning about the son, Solomon, and also the Christ to come. But the 16th verse is just about Jesus. Well, how do you know that? Listen, Paul states this in one of his sermons to the Jews. In Acts 13, we find that whole sermon. But listen to this from the 32nd verse here, beginning in the 32nd verse. "And we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers, that God has fulfilled this promise to our children in that he raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalm, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you.' And for the fact that he raised him up from the dead, no longer to return to decay, he has spoken in this way, 'I will give you the holy and sure blessing of David.' Therefore, he also says in another psalm," the 16th psalm, by the way, you will not allow your Holy One to undergo decay. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and laid among his fathers and underwent decay." Listen to the 37th verse. "But he whom God raised will not undergo decay." That's talking about Jesus. Folks, Jesus is on the throne now. He is the king and ruler of all the earth, including Israel. Now, I realize they have not at this point recognized him as the king, as the ruler, as God in the flesh. But they will. Okay? That prophecy back there was real. See, as we go through the first Kings, go through first Kings, actually 2 Kings 2, you see Jesus over and over and over. Why? Why is that? because the Bible, the whole Bible, both the Old Testament and the New Testament, both are about Jesus. Everything in the Scripture points to Jesus. Everything does. He's everywhere in it. It is His story all the way from Genesis all the way through the end of the Revelation. It is the story of Jesus. Okay? Now we could just camp out right there and talk about Jesus, couldn't we? And, you know, but we're going to go on because we're going to see Jesus again over and over and over in this story. Now, like I said just a moment ago, in the story of Bathsheba, we see the redemption of God toward an individual. We see that. But when we look at the third and fourth chapters of 1 Kings, we're going to see God's blessings on a nation, now watch this, whose leaders and people obey Him. Now, folks, God does bless nations wherein the leaders and the people obey Him. That's just truth. I know a lot of people say that's not true, but it is true. It is true. All right? Now, but first we need to look at chapter 2 here. In chapter 2 of 1 Kings, you're going to see something else about God. Listen, God does judge sin. And here we see God does judge sin, and especially the sin of rebellion. Now, we're going to look at this in sort of a running commentary. I can't read all of that to you, and you'd be scared to death if I started doing that today, right? Because you'd never get to eat, right? You know, okay, so I'm trying to respect your time in that. But look at the first four verses with me here. This is where David tells Solomon to be a man and follow God. All right, look at that with me, if you will. He said, "And David's time to die drew near. He charged Solomon his son, saying, 'I am going the way of all the earth. Be strong, therefore, and show yourself a man.'" And I'll talk about this when we do that youth study for guys, okay, that we're starting in July, all this kind of stuff. But listen to this verse. Here's how you show yourself a man. "Keep the charge of the Lord your God to walk in His ways, to keep His statutes, His commandments, His ordinances, and His testimonies, according to what is written in the law of Moses, that you may succeed in all that you do and wherever you turn, so that the Lord may carry out His promise which He spoke concerning me. If your sons are careful in their way to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel." Okay, now when we look at verse 3, he tells us how we are to be as people of God, as men of God. When we're talking to our sons, we need to let them know the primary thing in this life is to follow God. Follow God. Now, there are a lot of great things to learn, and you need to learn everything that you can. But the primary is to follow God. Now, David had learned that. He's on his deathbed, and he says, "Solomon, be a man, follow God." That's right there. And then, though, in verses 5 through 9, and these are difficult verses. I'll probably not read all of them. Well, I know I'm not going to. In verses 5 through 9, David tells Solomon how to deal with rebels. Okay? How to deal with rebels. There are tons of paper, so to speak, on this passage of Scripture, on the left and the right. Left-wing theologians say David was ungodly all of his life, you know, and then right-wing guys say, no, he had to do it, which, by the way, that's what I said when I was first started school. Okay, I got in trouble for that. But listen, when you read that, I'll read a little bit of it. Listen to this. Listen, there in the fifth verse. "Now you know also Joab." Joab had been David's general. "The son of Zeruiah, what he did to me, what he did to the commanders of the armies of Israel, to Abner the son of Ner, and Amasa the son of Jether, whom he killed. He also shed the blood of war in peace," meaning That means murder, okay, right there. It was not a just war, some of what Joab got involved in. He did this for his own gain. He put the blood of war on his belt, about his waist, and on his sandals, and on his feet. Now, listen, like I say, David had failed in his reign during the time when he was strong as a king to deal with Joab. In other words, he allowed Joab to slide. Joab murdered Abner. Joab murdered Amasa. Joab murdered Absalom. And no doubt there were others. And he was complicit in the murder of people that David wanted murdered. All right? And maybe because of that, David always let Joab slide. Now what he's doing on his deathbed, he's passing off the responsibility to Solomon. That's really what he's doing here in every bit of this. Because he failed to do what he was supposed to do as king. Look, folks, as leaders, we need to do what we are supposed to do. As Christians, we need to do what we're supposed to do. And kicking the can on down the road is just a nice metaphoric way of saying, I'm going to be a coward. Okay? Kicking a can down the road for somebody else to have to deal with is wrong. Now, you have suffered for it many times in your lives because the first thing a politician learns to do when he gets elected is kick that can. Just as far away from himself as he can, in both parties and any party. Okay? But leaders are supposed to be responsible. David was not in these things. And now on his deathbed he knows it, and he hands all this responsibility off to this young son who just became king, his name being naturally Solomon. Now, the lesson here is that we need to stand up to our own responsibilities in life. You know that? If people stood up to their own responsibilities in life, it'd be a better place to live, right? I mean, if we just did that. And we can't always place unnecessary burdens on other people. There's a commercial on TV that I hate. I hate it. I want to throw my shoes at the television. Y'all know that television about, you know, where that commercial where they advertise for this thing where you can call so-and-so and get work and bids and all that. And this guy standing out by his mailbox. Another guy walks up and he says, hey, do you know where I'm getting, I'm going to say plumbing, plumber, and the guy says, yeah. And then the other guy says, well, hey, call, get me estimates and all this junk. And I want to reach in TV and slap him, don't you? I hate that commercial. And you know why I hate? People will do you that way if you're not careful. Yeah. Well, why don't you do everything for me, you know? I remember when I was a kid in high school and I smoked, and people would bum cigarettes off of me because I always had cigarettes. Because I worked and had a job and I had cigarettes. Don't smoke. But this is an illustration. Don't smoke. This is an illustration. All right, listen. I'd be out at the smoking ramp at the high school, and I smoked Camel Nun filters. One reason I smoked them, well, the bigger reason I smoked because that's what Charlie smoked. And that's what you smoke, you know, Camel Nun filters, all right? And the other reason was so people wouldn't bum off of me, but people did. And people come up to you, y'all know this is true because some of you have done this to folks. They come up to you and say, give me a cigarette. They don't even say please. Oh, if you like them enough, you'll hand them a cigarette. And then they'll say this, you got a light? And so you're pulling your Zippo out, you know. And then you say this to try to get them to understand you're about tired of this. Hey, would you like for me to pump your lungs for you also so the smoke will go in there? You know, have you ever said? Yeah. Some people want you to do everything for them, okay? But that is wrong. We all need to stand up to our responsibilities. And here we've got the dying king giving orders, actually, to the oncoming king. You got to take care of all my messes. You got to clean up my stuff. Okay? Well, folks, now, that puts a hardship on Solomon. As a matter of fact, it will follow him. It will literally follow him, and we'll see this. We'll see this as we go through this book. We'll see how it was a hardship for him. You know, then when you get to the 10th verse, though. Now, David was an imperfect man, right? He wasn't perfect. But when you get to the 10th verse, we see David dies. He died and went the way of his fathers. He lived out his time, but I want you to hear this. The reign of King David was the most significant reign of any human king, any human emperor, any human ruler ever in the history of the earth. Now, naturally, it was not more significant than the rule of the God-man, Jesus, okay? But I'm talking about born of woman and a father. David's rule was more significant than any other. The reason was and always will be is because God decreed the Messiah, the very Son of God, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, would come from where? The house of David. He would come from the house of David over and over and over. That's stated in the Scriptures. Now listen to this. And I love this. I put this on the internet. Some of you responded to it. But David was by no means a perfect man. Okay? He was not a perfect man. He sinned against God many times. But I love this right here, and it's true. Yet God called David a man after my own heart. You can't help but think, well, then why would God say that? Look at all the junk he got into. Look at all the mess he did. You know, all the time fighting and feuding and riding around being an outlaw and stuff. You know, and killing people and taking folks' wives and, you know, counting the census and all them crazy things he did. Why would God say that about him? Well, here it is. Because even though David sinned grievously, he repented sincerely. His repentance was genuine. When David got in trouble, his repentance was not that kind of repentance you find in the world sometimes. When people say, oh man, I've got caught. I'm sorry. But they no more mean that than I would mean I was an Auburn fan. I mean, listen, they don't mean it. They lying if they say it. When I truly repent, if I am sincere in my repentance, buddy, I want to get as far away from that sin that has gripped me as I can. I want to turn away from it. And David was that way. I think Bathsheba was that way too. I think they repented sincerely before God, and God forgave them. And then he wrote in the 51st Psalm. You ever read the 51st Psalm? You ought to read the 51st. Any time that sin enters your life and you need and Satan's beating you to death, you read the 51st Psalm, okay? And in that Psalm, we find this, that God does not reject a broken and a contrite heart. Man, when your heart is broken before God and you repent of God and you hate your sin and you're turning away, God will forgive you. Don't that make you happy? Don't that make you glad? You know why? You know why that's true? Friends, listen to me. The blood atonement of Jesus is the one and only sufficient sacrifice stated in the entire Word of God that will forgive me of my sins. Jesus' atonement, what he did on the cross, is sufficient to wash away all my sin and yours if I come to God with a broken and contrite heart before him. A heart that rejects my sin. We need that. What did 1 John 1 and 9 say? I love this verse. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Don't you like that? Man, I like that, man. I know that when I repent of sin, when I'm serious with God and repent of sin, God will wash that away. And the 103rd Psalm says what? He'll remove it as far as the east is from the west. Right? It's never going to come up. Listen. According to the Scripture, according to the Bible, not according to CB, but according to the Bible, if you have repented of sin and trusted Jesus as your Savior, at the end of this way, when the judgment seat of Christ occurs, and that's the one Christians will be in front of, He's not going to bring up all your sins. That's not what's going to happen. I mean, what could you do about it anyway? He's going to bring you in home. You know why? Because He's washed away your sin. He's not going to confront you with that again. It's gone. I'm proud of that, aren't you? I mean, proud that He did that. Not proud of me. I didn't do it. I can't wash away my sins. I can't wash away my sins with Clorox and Ajax combined. By the way, don't do that either. That'll tear your lungs up. But trust me. But listen. You can't wash it away. But the blood of Christ washes clean. That's wonderful. Then we go on with this quickly here in verses 13 to 46. Those stories right there, really, God does bring judgment against rebellion in the hearts of unrepentant people. If we will not repent, judgment is coming. There's no way out of it. In the beginning of the 13th verse there of the second chapter, Adonijah, man, what? Solomon had spared, and I'm just going to tell it to you quickly, Solomon had spared Adonijah. You know, Adonijah ran over there to the tent of meeting and he grabbed a hold of the horns of the altar. And then Solomon sent for him and said, "Now look at here. You going to do this again?" Now I'm paraphrasing for you. You know, Solomon was southern. He was the wisest man in the world. Had to be from the south. But listen. He said, "Look here, big brother. You ever going to do this mess again? You going to rebel like this again, break the law of God and man, try to take the king? You going to do that?" "No, I promise I won't." "Well, then you'll go on down to your house and behave." Well, then what does he do? I think he got in cahoots with old Joab and Abiathar again. I do. And they cooked up this plan. And he goes to Bathsheba. Because Bathsheba's got more clout than anybody with King Solomon. That's King Solomon's mama. You love your mama, right? You know, you got to love your mama, don't you, boys? You love your mama no matter what. Even bad men love their mamas, right? Right? Don't remember that movie? Never mind. You lie anyway. You say you don't even watch picture shows or listen to music. Listen. She had clout with the king. So Adonijah goes and says, "Hey, I want to ask you a favor." She says, "What is it?" He says, "Well, I want you to tell Solomon to let me marry I forgot her name, Abishag or something like that. That little old gal that was taking care of David. Okay? Her name just ran out of my head. That's terrible. Abishag, what's her name? Say it again. Say it anyway. Abishag, that's good enough to suit me. I blew it out of the water. Abishag, okay? And he says, "I want you to talk to the king and see if he'll let me marry her." Well, so Bathsheba, and Bathsheba's wise. She knows what's going on here. She's not stupid, and so she's not even going to argue. Have you ever dealt with somebody that you thought, "I'm not even going to argue with him"? Have you ever had to do you're dealing with people and you think, "There ain't no need to even have this argument. I know what I'm about to do. It don't matter. And I know that if I try to explain it to them, they're not going to listen because they are stubborn and rebellious." So she's a wise woman. She says, "Okay, yeah, I'll do that." And all the way to the king, she knows what? This is the end of that boy. Yeah. Why? Because he's an absolute rebel against the will of God. You can't rebel against the will of God all your life and think it's going to work out well. It's not. Well, so she goes. She sees Solomon. Solomon, you know, bows down before her, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And then she says what? "Abishag, that took care of your daddy in his dying days, your brother Adonijah wants to marry her." And buddy, old Solomon, man, that lit him up. You ever seen somebody when they got lit up when they heard something? I mean, that lit the boy up. The 22nd verse says, "And King Solomon answered and said to his mama, to his mother, 'And why are you asking Abishag the Shunammite for Adonijah? Ask for him also the kingdom, for he's my older brother, even for him.'" And here it tells us that Abathar and Joab were probably into this. "Abathar the priest, and for Joab the son of Zahara." You know, don't just give him her, give him the whole kingdom. Now, that was rhetoric from an angry man. And then what did he do? Well, he sent for him, and he also sent for his number one guy now, Benaiah. Yeah. And he said, "You done this, and you're going to die." And judgment fell on Adonijah right there, because Benaiah never misses. He killed him. That was the judgment of God for absolute rebellion. See, God had given Adonijah mercy from Solomon. "Go on, I'm not going to harm you. You're my brother. Behave. You promised. Adonijah said, "Sure." But he is probably walking out of the house making his plan. You know, look, we have to understand, if we don't repent unto the Lord in truth, judgment's coming. That's what this whole chapter's about here, quickly. And then Abathar was a priest. Abathar had rebelled against God and man. Abathar knew that Solomon was supposed to be the successor to the kingdom. He knew that. He was the high priest of the land. Yet what happened to Abathar? He was removed as high priest. I mean, Solomon went ahead and removed him. Now, why did he remove him? Here it is. It's because Abathar, who was the high priest, he lost sight of his calling and purpose and sought his own self-interest. Now, folks, that can happen to us, right? We can, leaders in the Church of the Living God fall left and right because why? They lose sight of their purpose. They lose sight of their calling. And they start trying to take care of themselves. As a leader in the household of God, I've got to keep my focus on Jesus. If I don't, I'm doomed. And so is any preacher in the world. I want to tell you something. You can't get too big to be accountable before God. And I can guarantee you, I'll never come in here asking you to pray for me to get a jet. Matter of fact, I wouldn't even come in here asking you to pray for me to get a lawnmower. Because I just go back to my old ways and steal yours. No, I'm sorry. No. Look, that when you get like, now pay attention. When the man of God starts seeking his own self-interest all the time, now listen to me, something's wrong. Because our purpose is to fulfill the Great Commission and challenge whoever we're accountable for to do the same. That's the job. That's the calling. And Abathar was looking at David. He's going to die. And I know Adonijah likes me. I don't care what God said. I'm going to keep my house and Cadillac. Yeah, I am. I'm going to keep my gold and my Brooks Brothers robes. I'm going with Adonijah because Solomon's just a kid. No hope for that. And he might throw me out anyway. He was not looking to fulfill the truth of God. And so he was dismissed from his service. But even then, Solomon was gracious to him. He didn't kill him. He told him, get. Basically, that's the word, get. And he made somebody else the high priest. That's a lesson for us. And then boy old Joab comes up, 28th verse. As a matter of fact, I want you to look at verse 29, and this gives us an insight to Joab. Quickly, right here. It, you know, when Joab finds out Adonijah's dead, 29th verse says, "And it was told King Solomon that Joab had fled to the tent of the Lord, and behold, he is beside the altar." Joab had sought his self-interest his entire adult life. There was never a time when Joab, and you can read his whole story through 1 and 2 Samuel, you'll find this, it's all the way through there. There was never a time that he was seeking to serve God. He was seeking to make sure that his position was always secure. That's the reason he hated Abner. Abner was a smarter war general than was Joab, okay? And Joab hated him with that, and so he killed him, all right? And then he killed Amasa. And he certainly didn't want Absalom on the throne, not because he really cared, but because he had a good thing going with David, all right? And here's another thing about him. We need to understand this. The only time that Joab ever had anything to do with religion was when he was preserving himself. That's when he ran to the tent. That's when he grabbed hold of the horns of the altar. That's when he claimed religion, okay? That's when he was claiming to be right with God. When he needed an out, he was going to use God as a shield. Now, some of you don't know what a shield is. A foil. You're just using somebody. Listen, folks, we can't use God. And a lot of people try to do that. This guy tried to do that. Solomon saw through it. You know what he said? He sent Benaiah. Man, if you hear Benaiah's coming, you better run. You know, y'all remember that old song? Eli's coming. Benaiah's coming. He is coming. And he went, and then he goes back, and he says, well, you know, Benaiah's a godly guy, really. He says, Lord, Solomon, he's holding hands on the horns of the altar. You know what Solomon said? Go back over there. Because Joab said, if you're going to kill me here. And Solomon said, do as he wishes. And they killed him. That was the judgment of God. That's the judgment of God. And then he also, old Shimei, who had cussed David and cussed Israel, and you know, he was always playing back and forth. He was a man. You find his story in the 36 through the 46 verses. He was a man who was offered the grace of God because Solomon had told him, I tell you what, I'm not going to kill you, but you build your house. You build your house here in the city of Jerusalem, and you stay there. Don't you be running around anywhere. Now, there's background on that. He didn't want him going out and causing rebellion out among the tribes. He didn't want that. He said, you stay at the house. As long as you stay at the house, you take care of yourself in town. And there was everything he might want in Jerusalem. They had Walmart there and everything. Don't you just love Walmart? But anyway, listen. You stay in Jerusalem. But Shimei couldn't even do that. He rebelled against that. He heard that some of his slaves had sneaked off to join up with a group over at Gath. And so he saddled his mule and he took off to get him. Well, just as soon as he crossed, somebody went and told the king, Shimei done run off, king. What you going to do now? Well, the king already knew. He brought him home, had him put to death. Listen, my friend. And I'll have to take up the rest of this actually next week because the third chapter is full of the grace of God. But we've talked about that today. David received grace. He was a sinful man, but God gave him grace. The story of blessing is found in the third and the fourth chapter, really. And it's of great importance. We'll take that up next week. Listen, God blesses those who obey Him. You understand that? God blesses those who obey Him. Now, again, that's not sinless perfection. Obeying God is having a sensitive heart to God. And when we fail God, we quickly repent. Repent, repent. Get away from it. Leave it alone. God blesses those. But at the same time, there's judgment coming. If we rebel against God in this life, we have no hope in the next life. We are hopeless. I cannot live a life of rebellion against God and expect to be okay in eternity. I have told you many times, you're going to live in one of two places. Either you're going to live in heaven because you have received Jesus and He has saved you and He's going to give you a home. I'll say it like the old song does, give me a home in glory. All right? And if you do not receive Jesus, you will spend eternity in hell. You can't make it any plainer than that. That's just reality. Now, you saw the stories of these men. And actually, they were given grace. But yet, they rebelled and rebelled and rebelled. Adonijah's heart was so twisted with his desire to be king and not obey God that he would do anything. And I want to tell you something. When you get to the point in life that you will do anything to achieve a goal, you're in trouble. What do I mean by that? If you will compromise your ethics and your integrity and your honor, or the integrity and honor of someone else to achieve your goal, you're in serious spiritual trouble. God will not abide that. God will not abide that. It happens all the time. We need to humble ourselves before the Lord and get right with Him. You know that? And we need to be humble before the Lord all the time. Man, sometimes we need to slap our own faces. I mean, sometimes it's just good to stand up in the front of the mirror and just slap the forehead of your face. You ever done that? I mean, when you do, your kids think you're crazy if they stand looking at you. But they think, what is wrong with my daddy? He slapped his brains out. I want to tell you something. The Bible says we need to humble ourselves before the Lord, right? I need to humble myself before the Lord. I need to humble myself before the Lord. And that's what David did when he sinned. That's what Bathsheba did. That's what many, many more did. We'll see that that's what Solomon does when we get to the third chapter, and people in the kingdom did. And that's what we need to do today. If I will humble myself before the Lord, He will give me, how's our song go? He will give me Jesus. Right? Let's have an invitation and give people an opportunity right now. Look, my friend, these stories are real, they're biblical. There's practical application in every one of them. There's a spiritual truth in everything there. It's not hard. If I obey the Lord, He'll bless my life. If I disobey the Lord, I'm hopeless. And the primary way we obey the Lord is come to His Son, Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Will you pray with me? Father, I ask You to touch lives. Help people to see that if they surrender all to You, that You'll take care of them. That You will give them a new life in Christ. Father, help them to seek that, even in this moment. We ask You that in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand, if you know this is what you need to do, you come right on and tell somebody.